Hi, I'm Alberto, AI scientist at Bending Spoons, and I'd like to present Faster Than Light on-device shotcut detection, on which I worked with my colleague Davide Carletti. So a video is composed of multiple shots or scenes which are connected by cuts, and our goal is to find where each cut is located. In this work, we specifically address social media videos, and you'll see why this can be surprisingly challenging. Here, for example, we can see six different cuts joining different parts of the video. Cuts denote the start and end of each shot. If we know where a cut is located, we can easily replace shots. For example, let's say that here we don't like the middle shot. If we know where it starts and ends, we can easily replace it with another one that we like more. Or we can also replace every single shot to get a new video that has the same structure of the previous one, but different content. If you think this problem for a few minutes, you'll immediately think of a few baseline algorithms that can identify the location of each cut. For example, you can look at the difference of average RGB value of subsequent frames and mark the frame as a cut if the difference is above a threshold. And then you can also say that you're not going to add any other cut for the next 24 frames, which is what would usually happen for movies. However, if we start looking at some real videos, we'll see that this assumption might not always hold. First, a video might contain flashing lights, as in this example. As such, techniques that simply rely on color differences might get fooled and predict non-existing cuts. Then, smooth cuts are also a problem, because we don't have a sudden change between one scene and the next. However, we need to identify the central frame of the transition, which could be difficult if the transition, as in this case, happens with a very smooth gradient. In this work, we specifically handle social media videos, and they are much more difficult to process than traditional videos or movies, as they contain different kinds of cuts. First, it is common to have rapid sequences of images, as in end-of-year recap video. Here, each image lasts for just a fraction of a second, or even for just a couple of frames. And as such, our heuristic, which leaves 24 frames between cuts, will simply not work at all. Then, we have videos where cuts are intentionally hidden, as in magic tricks. Here we cannot rely on color differences, but we need models that can build a better understanding of the content of the video. And finally, it is common to have videos with static background, as in dance videos that you can find on TikTok. Once again, relying on simple color differences between frames will not work to find these cuts. But actually, the biggest challenge we face is not detecting cuts, but doing so on a mobile device. This is because we want to include this feature in an existing mobile application, and asking users to upload their videos on a remote server would not be practical, due to too slow upload speeds being common, and also due to privacy considerations that must be kept into account. As such, we need extremely small models, as we cannot increase by a large amount the size of the existing app, and we also need these models to be very fast, because users cannot afford to wait minutes to obtain a result, and because we cannot drain the device battery just to process a single video. This means avoiding large video models that are state-of-the-art in video understanding tasks, and also avoiding operators that cannot be easily optimized on mobile devices, such as dilated convolutions. We can divide existing methods into two categories. First, we have commercial solutions, which are readily available to everyone, but whose implementation details are not public. And then we have open source or research work on which we can build upon. Specifically, PyScenDetect is a well-known Python library that looks at color differences between frames. Ridiculously fast shot boundary detection with fully convolutional neural network is a paper from 2018 that proposes a simple but fast model for shotcut detection and we actually took it as starting point of our work. Finally, Transnet is a model proposed in 2020, which is much more complex than the previous one, but also provides state-of-the-art results in shortcut detection. To give you some additional details, PyCinDetect uses a heuristic very similar to the one I proposed at the start. It computes a rolling average of the hue, saturation and luminance for each frame in the video, and then if the current frame has an average HSL, which is more different than a threshold compared to the rolling average, it is going to flag it as a cut. And then it is going to make sure that for the next 15 frames, we don't have any other cut. It is very simple, but at the same time, it is also very fast and better than some baseline method based on neural networks. However, it is also unable to deal with more complex situations, such as fast cuts or the presence of hidden cuts, as the ones in the videos we have seen. As such, we cannot really use it for our purpose, and we need to build something a bit more powerful. We measured how good these existing methods are on a variety of videos. Here, a true positive is a frame that denotes the start of a new shot and is correctly identified as such. We use F1 to give equal importance to false negative and false positives, and also consider F1 at 3 to measure if we can approximately identify the start of a new shot. We use a variety of TikTok videos, from dance videos, end of year recap, and videos with hidden cuts, and we also use a naturalistic documentary to add variety to our validation data. F1 on this documentary tends to be a bit lower, as it contains smooth transitions where each frame belonging to the transition is flagged as a cut, while we only care about the central frame. We see that different techniques perform better or worse on different datasets, but the simple heuristic in PyCinDetect is competitive with some of the best commercial tools, and Transnet is, on average, the best performing model. So for our first experiments, we used a very simple architecture. A frozen backbone, such as ResNet 18, applied to individual frames, followed by a simple MLP that combined the features extracted from each frame to understand if the central frame was a cut. Truth be told, this approach did not work well, as temporal information is aggregated only at the very end of the network. Moreover, even a small ResNet 18 still contains a few million parameters, making the total model more than 50 megabytes, which is too much for our application. Instead, we went back to this paper from 2018 and realized how 3D convolution play a key role in shortcut detection, as they combine temporal information across different frames from the very start of the network. In the end, our final network is a sequence of simple 3D convolutions followed by batch normalization and a dense layer. There are, however, a couple of key differences between our model and the original one, which are worth pointing out. First of all, our model is bigger, containing about 80,000 parameters, which is twice as much as the original model. However, this also results in a 2% F1 increase, making the extra parameter worthwhile. Second, our model processes videos at 48x48 resolution instead of 64x64, resulting in a 2.4 faster execution time. So, even though our input videos might have less information due to the lower resolution, we can still extract more information from it thanks to the bigger network. To train our model, we do not rely on annotated data as in previous work, but instead employ only synthetically generated cuts. That's because annotated data is scarce and is mostly composed of movies instead of social media videos, our intended application domain. We generate cuts by joining two random shots or by joining different parts of the same shot to create a more complex training sample from which we can learn. We randomize the location of the synthetic cut in a window of 17 frames, and we have to predict which is the frame that contains the cut. Simply creating fake cuts does not, however, fully capture the range of difficult situations that arise when processing videos in the wild. As such, we introduce further augmentations, such as adding motion blur and random frame-wise changes of brightness and color to reduce the number of false positives that are predicted by our model. So we compared our method to all the other baselines and we obtained the best average F1. We also retrained Transnet from scratch and improved its performance by 3-4%, proving that our training strategy is actually very effective. That said, this retrained Transnet has the same F1 of our much smaller Mini3D model, and Transnet is also 100 times bigger, so it's not really worth using. If we also look at the speed of these different models, our model really leaves everyone in the dust, being 28 times faster than the second fastest technique. Of course, we don't just care about the aggregate performance, but we want to analyze where our model is underperforming. We plot predictions for each video in the hard clip dataset, the one containing hidden cuts and magic tricks. Although the average F1 is pretty low, at 64%, we see how failures are entirely happening on a single video. These cuts are extremely difficult to spot, and even a human annotator will have problems to pinpoint their exact location. On the other hand, we see in the second example how the model successfully handled cases where there are minimal color differences between the shots, and so finding the cut is pretty difficult if using a more traditional heuristic. In the plot on the right, we can see how the F1 on this dataset will change for different classification threshold. And although the best result is achieved with a threshold of 0.61, picking a different threshold like 0.5 will still give a good result, which means that our model is actually quite robust. In practice, we use the best threshold found during validation, which is 0.6, and we use the same threshold for every dataset. After validating the performance of our model, we exported it using ONNX to make it usable on mobile devices, both on iOS and Android. We ran the model on the phone CPU as no neural network mobile library supports hardware acceleration for 3D convolutions, to the best of our knowledge. Even there, we measure unmodified accuracy and speed comparable, if not even exceeding, an high-end server CPU. Our work will soon be available in Splice, so stay tuned if you want to play with it. In the meantime, I leave you to our standalone demo so you can get a feeling of how our model works. Thank you.